A very good morning to all of you here at Aldersgate Methodist Church, and greetings from my home church in Changi Baptist in the Eastern Shore of Singapore, from Care Channels, my mission sending agency, as well as the Village Home Care Team, Shalom Home Care in Sankuburi, Thailand. It's really a joy to be here to worship with you this morning, and it's tremendous to see the heart of missions that's beating in Aldersgate. So let's start off with a word of prayer today. Dear Abba Father, we pray for your light to shine forth in our lives, to open the eyes of our heart as we search the scriptures and invite you to search our hearts. Speak to us through your word, lead us forward, and grant us a joyous faith lived out in righteous actions to restore this world to shalom in Christ Jesus. Amen. Okay, good morning. Well, my name is Jen. I'm a general surgeon based at Khoo Teck Puat Hospital. And as you can see, it's a big hospital. Compared to the small hospital that I've been working with and volunteering with called Kwai River Christian Hospital until 2020. This is in the rural western border between Thailand and Myanmar. This is where I first met Dr. Vivian, and then later on her visits with us, and later on got to meet Dr. Linus. The work we do is with the rural poor and displaced people in our community, and it's evolved from the hospital work as well to community-based nursing care work. So there you can see Dr. Vivian on one of her visits with us. My work is as the unofficial Medifund support to this team. And the Medifund stands for being the mobilizer, equipper, developer, and initiator of some of the work. And my wife calls it the instigator for some of this work. And so I say this because I'm not a traditional person who just gets funding from outside and serves there. I'm also a supporter, so it puts me in a position where many of you are, where I'm also looking at how the money I use is being used overseas, but I also have had the opportunity to see how it's being used and to live there and spend some time. So today I share with you from that background. With me today is my dear wife, Liz, and my three daughters, Zayn, Zadi, and Dalit. Liz is the iron lady of our home. She takes care of all the logistics, the support, and has really been the one who's prepared our family for the work that we do overseas. I'm gonna stop playing with this. It seems to move on its own. She is an iron lady because as iron sharpens iron, she sharpens me. And as a surgeon, as someone who appreciates how compassionate and skillful surgical steel can bring healing, I also grudgingly have to accept the wounds of a friend that actually are more trusted than the kisses of an enemy. And she's the Iron Lady because her character brings the strength and resilience to our ministry. So when I speak today about the roles of missions that there are for the layperson, I'm especially wanting all of you to hear how God uses people of all backgrounds in missions, not just doctors, and how God especially uses families, not just as support, but also as frontliners in this ministry. And so my family have very much shared in this ministry with me together. So today I'm gonna share with you some dangerous truths and ask you to pray dangerously, effectively, and also to challenge you to live out your lives in joyful obedience. But let's start first with the words of Isaiah, and then let me bring you through a journey to a part of the world that's close to my heart. So we join Isaiah and the Israelites as they have just returned from exile to a ruined nation, and they're fasting, and they're praying, and they're keeping the Sabbath, although in a legalistic sort of way, with empty observances, and they're seeking a response from God and the answer to their troubles, and to have God's presence in the temple again. So in Isaiah 58, verse 6, God shares his heart to them through Isaiah, saying, "Is this not the kind of fasting I have chosen, to loose the chains of injustice and to untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and to break every yoke?" So let me ask you, friends, what is the purpose of fasting and Sabbath keeping? Is it to honor God. And the kind of fasting that brings honor to God, the God of love and goodness and mercy, is the kind of fasting that shares your food with the hungry, to provide shelter for the homeless, to clothe the naked, and to not turn away from the less fortunate. We honor God when we care for the needy. This was in our heart too, as a couple. I first met Liz in university. In my own journey, which is a story for another time, I knew I was to keep myself ready to be out to help the less fortunate. We met in our senior year in university, and I knew there's something special about this gal. After courting her over 6 years, 5 years of which were overseas, there are many different ways to play hard to get. But for her, the main issue that she had to resolve in her heart was whether or not God would allow her to continue achieving her purpose set aside for reaching out in missions when she married me. And so thankfully God addressed that, and we've been married 24 years. But it took a while for us to get there. And so after we were married, she joined me for my residency training in the US. We came back to Singapore, had children, settled into a typical Singapore life, you know, comfortable, connected, committed, serving in our church, children in school, career advancing. 12 years had passed since we had gotten married. And then Liz, the iron lady of our home, iron sharpens iron, reminded me gently of the Isaiah 58 fasting that we had committed to, and that the journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. So, over the next 3 years, we began to intentionally use our vacation time to travel up and meet and learn from missionaries and mission projects in the region, to learn from how to recognize the heart of missions that was beating inside them, and what sustained them in the work that they were doing, and how we could be useful in that. So if we remember, the purpose of fasting is to align ourselves with God's presence and divine purpose so that we can draw near to God, surrender ourselves to God, and hear God's direction. And then we can steel ourselves with determination to do God's will. Then it makes perfect sense what Isaiah is talking about. Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer, and you will cry for help, and he will say, "Here am I." And in verse 11, it continues, "The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land, and he will strengthen your frame." So this is a fast, not just to be hungry. It's a fast for the hungry. So when we fast effectively, we align ourselves with God's heart for the oppressed, the hungry, and the poor, and the homeless. And this comes with a huge promise. This promise is to be guided by God and to have the incredible joy of his presence and being included in his master plan. So from these short-term visits to being missionaries, how did tiny Hue Malai village on the Thai-Myanmar border become part of the plan? We had called out, and the Lord answered. So our first journey was a surprise to us. It was late 2014, and our family had been a month visiting missionary friends in Kalimantan Bethesda Surakam Hospital. And there, one of the missionaries that we were visiting talked to us about an opportunity to serve and help out the needs in Kwai River Christian Hospital in Thailand. It seemed a bit crazy at first. I'd used up all my leave for the year, and as I talked more to the OMF missionary surgeon, you can see him in the top corner of the slide there, I realized that a veteran missionary surgeon wasn't just a surgeon. He was covering the roles of almost everything medical over there in terms of OBGYN, psychiatry, pediatrics, surgery, urology, general medicine, tropical disease. Board certified as a general surgeon. But general doesn't begin to cover all the roles that a missionary surgeon in the jungle has to cover. So I realized this is going to be a problem. I don't do anesthesia. How am I going to help? So as we talked further, he said, "Come make a short trip." So Liz and I managed to scrounge up a few more days of leave in the beginning of the year. We went out for a short trip together, and there you can see Liz in the morning, once a week, weekly market. So all your shopping is done once a week in the early morning. You can see her there. And if you can see all the chickens laid out there, that's how you buy your food in the market. So we went there and became convinced of the good work being done by the hospital, the real needs that were there, and we began to pray. And also to pray about how God would begin to direct us as a family. So I applied for leave. Leave was granted. And so I made arrangements to go. And the arrangement was they would get an anesthesiologist to come and support me because I wasn't going to operate on people that weren't asleep and weren't out of their pain. So in God's humor and divine provision, the anesthetist who was supposed to come out with me for the 4 months ended up being able to come out just for a few weeks. And then the plan changed. And so at first they were supposed to come out and help me do all the operations. Then they were going to try and teach me how to do the most basic form of anesthesia, kind of spinal anesthesia. And he said, oh sure, you'll be able to learn this, quite easy. And then as we got the first cases in, she said, you know, actually I haven't done this for a long time. I've been working on children. So I'll do the first one or two cases and you watch. And then after that, I'll get you to do it. And I come from the old school of medicine. See one, do one, teach one. So I said, okay, I can do that. So I paid very close attention, watched very carefully as how she did the first one, two cases, and then the do one never came. She had to go back. And so when she left the hospital, it was really quite a big part of my prayer life blossoming as I began to pray really hard. I was quite quietly confident I could take care of the surgical parts of things, but I was quite terrified about the anesthesia part and violating this principle of first do no harm. But God actually took care of each patient. And as emergency cases came in, he provided for me a well-trained operating theater missionary nurse. She has a high school education. She's taken care of all the patients with missionaries over 20 years. And she came alongside me and said, don't worry. All the missionary surgeons who have come here have all had to go through this prayerful learning curve as well. I said, if it doesn't work, it's okay. We'll just give them more sedation. So with this kind of reassurance by my side, we had appendicitis, we had obstructed cesarean sections obstructed labor cesarean sections, wound care, traumas, emergencies, and bit by bit, understood that this wasn't really about me, what I bring to the mission field is what God provides. And I say this to all of you as well. Those of you who are unsure if the backgrounds that God has given you are ready for the kind of challenges you will face if you put yourself out there without the rest of the teams you have at work, God will provide that. So I returned from this four-month experience to Singapore with a full heart, full of the personal witness of God's presence and power working tangibly, but also a heart full of a new and growing burden for the rural, poor, and disabled peoples there. So here you can see, this is before my time, early 1990s, Kwai River Christian Hospital, and they're still using bullock carts as a primary mode of transportation. And so in a bullock cart, you know, we talk about God saying, come, give me your burdens, because my burden is easy to carry. And as we take on God's heart, he lifts off our burdens as we take on his heart for the suffering and the needy around us. This became even more personal as I wrestled over the next few months about what to do next, and eventually led to my decision to tender my resignation in order to serve in Kwai River Christian Hospital full time. I remember that during that time, I sort of envied Liz. She had the gentle support of having a divinely appointed dream to reassure her and seemed to be quite at peace. Certainly under the surface, I knew that God was working with her with her own struggles, speaking to her heart to calm her own fears about taking on the role of becoming a homeschool teacher, something that she would never have chosen to do unless God had first prepared her heart. But she was a homemaker by this point, and so when I was drafting my letter of resignation, it really hit me that while we had some savings, I was putting my career onto the balance. I remember praying, dear God, how do I know that this is really you, that this is really your plan, that I won't be back thinking that I misunderstood your call? Oh, that you would give me a sign as clear as Liz's dream, or a fleece, or angelic messenger. I know those things would be helpful. So I know that's your divine command. And when I come back someday, you know, with looking back at what's left, I'll know that this is what you have chosen for me. And I prayed, but God didn't answer that prayer in that direct way. What he did do was to impress upon my heart his heart's cry for the community there in Sankaburi district. So gradually, there will be times in prayer where I would just sense this profound love that God had for this community. And stepping out obediently in that direction came with a deep peace of God's presence and the verse 11 promise to lead and to guide. So some of you are wondering, how does this apply to laypersons? The first dangerous truth, it was that I was mistaken in what I was asking God for. We don't need a specific, special, supernatural calling in order to be involved with God's mission. He has already given all of us the command to go and make disciples of all nations in Matthew 28:19. And in Isaiah 58, he tells us the fasting is for everyone who wants to be guided, to be led by and satisfied by God's presence. All we need is a broken heart. If we allow our heart to be reshaped into God's heart for the lost. So participating in God's mission does not require divine calling. Sometimes we misunderstand the Bible stories of individuals chosen and set aside by God to serve for a particular purpose. Like when God called Abraham to the promised land or chose Paul to preach the gospel to the Gentiles. Those of us who don't feel specifically called may feel discouraged, thinking that we need a supernatural calling for meaningful involvement in missions. There are many unnamed faithful, as well as Barnabases, Lukes, and Timothys, and unnamed faithful. The list goes on. The truth is, God usually works through our individual gifts and talents rather than just a particular calling. In other words, God will use us in his mission through our everyday lives and the abilities that he has given us. Remember Priscilla and Aquila, who served with Paul? They journeyed with Paul and used their tent-making business to spread the gospel. Then they continued to work there even after Paul went on, turning their everyday working life into missions. This includes the families as well. The adults may be excited among you to see how you can use your work to be part of missions, but in our rural border village, our children made friends with the local village community and brought these children back to our home, played with them outside, and then eventually were able to bring some of these children and sometimes their parents to our local church where they have the opportunity to hear the gospel for the very first time. Back in Singapore, now a bit older, they have continued supporting our ministry by fundraising, through baking sales, inviting youth group friends over for short-term visits, and continuing overseas friendships with the pre-believers' friends. So I'm tremendously encouraged to see your mission team going out to Timor-Leste and what this means, developing this heart in your community. The second dangerous truth is the driving force of missions is not the command to go and make disciples of all nations. It's actually much deeper than that. Missions comes as a natural response to our delight and joy in God. Verse 14 speaks of this. It says, Then you will find your joy in the Lord. I will cause you to ride in triumph on the heights of the land and to feast on the inheritance of your father Jacob. In Thessalonians, Paul speaks of how we loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God of our lives as well, but because you had become so dear to us. The glory of God and our joy in him is the heart of missions. John Piper writes, the goal of missions is the gladness of peoples in the greatness of God. So understanding that calling is not a calling from the outside, is not straining our ears to hear needs that are far away, but rather a command that bursts forth from within. It comes from the deep gratitude and inexpressible joy of our new hearts and renewed minds in Christ. It comes from being co-heirs and seeing God's mighty hand moving through our lives and longing for the kingdom of God to be established on earth as it is in heaven. And our natural response to the presence of God's glory and being invited to be part of this magnificent plan is a dangerous prayer that Isaiah prays in chapter 6, verse 8. Here am I, send me. So Isaiah 58, verse 3 also reminds us then of this collective responsibility, the collective we, as in why have we fasted and humbled ourselves? So as lay persons and every persons in the church, we have an essential part to play. We are all part of God's great commission, yes, but that is not the same as a mistaken idea that we are all missionaries. Making Christ known in your native context is called evangelism, and it's an essential part of following Christ, like kicking the ball in soccer. While the term missions historically means crossing over geographical or cross-cultural boundaries to make Christ known, and that's also the objective of everyone who is under the Great Commission. We are not all called to be missionaries, just like not everyone is a striker on a soccer team. But if everyone's a striker, then we're not playing the field smartly to get through the enemy's defenses. But we're definitely all on the same team. And every member of the team may be called upon to take that penalty shot. So every training session and every touch in the field makes a difference. This is the third dangerous truth. Missions is a team sport, and we are not spectators. We have to be part of the team. We are all parts of the same body. Not everyone is made to be a hand or a foot. We know that God's heart is for us to go and make disciples of all nations. But some parts of the body will necessarily serve as an internal framework. Others provide sustenance. Others the muscle to empower the hands to reach out across the border, the boundaries. And the organism has to work in harmony, swiftly reacting to the neural commands from the head. Otherwise, we won't be able to work with agile and purposeful actions and bring steadiness to the flailing world. The truth is also that missional fasting will cost you. This is a fasting of things present, sometimes the things we take for granted. Sometimes it means letting go of comforts, recognition, and family. Mostly it's the little things that you didn't know would irk you until they do. Like making a conscious choice not to have a car until you're late and it's raining and you can't find a Grab. Or not having a home in Singapore when you retire and come back. We are not in this for awards or acclaim. It's for the heavenly recognition of well done, good and faithful servant. Still, sometimes it stings when the people you see who you feel are less capable are moving ahead in responsibilities and accolades. And then, fasting from family is probably the hardest. My parents need my care. They desire to hold their grandchildren. And sometimes it doesn't mean, there's plenty of time for that in heaven. It doesn't mean forsaking your family, but it means entrusting them into God's hands. Sometimes it means a loss of the physical or financial security for the children, not being able to think about overseas universities as a backup plan for them. Sometimes it exposes them to increased risk, not usually physical. It can be spiritual attacks, losing opportunities for their advancement, not fitting in well into schools when you come back, moving often and without warning, leaving friends behind. But most of all, it's a learning to be humbly dependent and trusting in God's sovereignty. But the fasting of things present in closeness and joy is not just for missionaries. It's for every Christian who has a longing for Christ's exaltation in the world. And as John Piper says, there are only three options for the Christian and missions: being a goer, being a sender, or being disobedient. So the fifth dangerous truth then is that missional living begins in your inner life. In verse 12 it says, you will become a repairer of broken walls. This speaks of one who restores a way of righteousness, beginning with him or herself. And as you repair your own personal breaches, God helps you rebuild what our enemy has destroyed, and we naturally become the restorers of streets to live in, making our churches and our neighborhoods into places of welcome, safe havens for the hurting and those in need. The church that takes on these small steps of inner life obedience as a community begins to live out the the incarnational fasting against injustice, and gains the promises of verses 8 and 10. Then your life will break forth like the dawn, and your life will rise in the darkness. But there is a choice. And if you remember this from The Matrix, there's the big if, red pill or blue pill. Verses 9 and 10 highlight this. If you will do away with the yoke of oppression, and if you will spend yourself on behalf of the hungry, then your light will rise in the darkness. We are commanded to be missional, not just to talk missional. What if I told my teenage daughters, hey, go and clean your room? And after half an hour, she said, hi, Dad, I've done a Greek and Hebrew lemma study on the topic of cleaning rooms, and here's what I found about it. Or I'm exploring the hermeneutics of the passages, and after an hour, Dad, I've written a draft policy on cleaning rooms and the biblical context. I'll look at her and say, that's crazy. Go and clean your room, enough. Sometimes our church committees can be a little bit like that. The tremendous effort of creating the one policy to rule them all can lull us into thinking that we've fulfilled our obligations through a document. Policies are important, but they only set a framework for transforming our strategic plans into practical action. The unfortunate truth is that we are getting better at incorporating missional wording into mission policies, and more and better than that, than getting the work done. Joseph Chien, the strategic coordinator for Antioch 21, highlights this problem. And you can see in these slides here, the little gray bars over here are what used to be what Singapore did in the year 2000 in terms of numbers of missionaries and people overseas. And the colored bars you see on the side are where we are now in 2020. This is from a Gordon Conwell Theological Seminary survey repeated in 2020. And it shows that 20 years on, the Singapore church has become wealthier, better equipped, more sophisticated, and much more traveled. But missions sending has taken a sharp dive. The 2020 survey shows the number of missionaries sent from Singapore has dropped by half. Most of our elder beloved missionaries have retired and returned home with no one to run the next lap in their shoes. Churches that adopted unreached people groups have unadopted them in favor of partnering established churches in reached people groups. Long-term, on-site, incarnational missionaries are a vanishing species. My friends, there is a problem. So what do we do? As a church, we need to be a little risky. We need to go beyond the safe bets of adopting and partnering with existing churches overseas and cast our bread upon the waters. Yo Seng Eng, a missionary mentor of mine and a veteran missionary in the Philippines, founder of Care Channels, explains, we are often taken advantage of in the work that we do. We've been cheated hundreds of times. It's common. Anyone who ministers in this area will need to be able to process how they see this. If not, it can be very poisonous for the soul. We can set aside a portion of the church's budget to do pioneering work. We must intentionally recruit, equip, and train and send out pioneer missionaries who incarnate themselves among forgotten peoples in forgotten places to share the good news, make disciples, and plant churches that plant churches. We can coordinate support and member care for those who are overseas. We can visit and care for the elderly in the families of those who have gone out long term. And this picture here on the side is to remind us our mission policies should be seen as a garden trellis to encourage things to grow up and out, and not primarily as a hedge fence to establish boundaries and to protect. As individuals, using intentionality and creativity, set aside a personal budget dedicated to missions, and even harder, commit to get to know, pray for, visit, and walk a short-term visit in the shoes of those you're supporting. Some of you have the ability to mentor essential life skills in those going out, modeling for young missionaries, a faithful walk with God, faithful singlehood, healthy marriages, time management, parenting, budgeting, healthy conflict resolution. Provide opportunities for tent making, for the missionary skills that missionaries may need to go out with. elder brothers and sisters who have gone through missions and are further along the journey can provide support along the way and loving insight. Be part of someone's support team. If you don't feel as if you're part of a team in missions, it's because you may still be a spectator and not yet being part of the team. The last dangerous truth is this. Oops. Okay. There are no simple solutions. The passage of Isaiah 58 is not a cookbook recipe or a three-step plan. It is a lifelong posture of the heart and a commitment to run the race until the finish line. Poverty is not a simple issue. The cause of poverty is unique for every family. Therefore, the solutions to help them journey out is different. The prescription to poverty is that there is no one-size-fits-all. Be ready to count the cost. Take on the challenges of the Good Samaritan. The hardest part of the radical thing that he did is what he did last in the story. So in the morning, he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, "Take good care of him. If it costs any more, put it on my bill. I'll pay you on the way back." Luke 10:25 in the Message version. Are we willing to be cheated by the local innkeeper? Or will we pull back our missions funding before we return to check on the injured man? The way forward as a lay person in missions and as a church in mission is not just ambling alone down a familiar path, but it's more like the team orienteering and overcoming obstacles in an amazing race. The call to work out our salvation with fear and trembling as we rely on God's strength and wisdom alone. It's a glorious call with the amazing promise that the Lord will answer us and guide us and satisfy us. But it is a path not often trodden. David Livingstone, pioneer missionary to Africa, received a letter saying, "Have you found a good road to where you are? If so, we want to know how to send other men to join you." Livingstone replied, "If you have men who will come only if there is a good road, I do not want them. I want those who will come where there is no road at all." My prayer for each of you is that you will take on the challenge of going out as a church unified where there is no road at all, of fasting forward in the Isaiah 58 way to places where people are unreached, that you will be a well-coordinated mission soccer team. No spectators, each member intentionally giving up what is precious in the now in order to gain what is priceless for eternity. Thank you very much.